the book of James that we have been studying. And if you want to catch the whole series, you can log on to our website or go to our YouTube channel, Tamiami Baptist Church, and then look up there the James teachings. To sport my glasses. James chapter 3. Before we go on to James chapter 3, let me recap a couple of things that we saw in James chapter 2, because James chapter 2 is a very important chapter. It's one that presents a lot of challenges and a lot of controversy, and we dealt with that last week, but let's just sort of recap real quick and ask a couple of questions that are very significant to this chapter. For example, when we read in James chapter 2, in verse 21, we read, "Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar?" Verse 22, "Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect?" And then you go on to verse 24, "You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only?" Wow, right? We see that and say, wow, wait a second. So which one is it? Is it by faith alone as we proclaim, or is it by works, or perhaps is it by faith and works, right? And last week, we went back to Paul and we established what Paul teaches in terms of our justification before God, that it is by faith alone. We went to Romans chapter 2, Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 4, and then we went to Galatians chapter 3 and made the case once again to be reminded that justification, and when we talk about justification, we're saying simply this: to be accepted before God, to be accepted before God. And we saw with Paul that we are accepted before God by faith alone, without the works of the law. Faith simply means to trust, to believe, to trust yourself to the person and the work of Christ for you, to believe the gospel, which simply means that Christ was crucified, suffered, was buried, and rose for our sins as the atoning sacrifice, or the sacrifice that takes away the sins of the world, so that we may be freely forgiven, meaning without our works. So the question then is, what is James talking about when it comes to this? We're justified by works. And the two questions that are significant, meaningful here, or important, are the following. Where are we justified by works and not by faith alone? And before whom are we justified by works and not by faith alone? And now this gives us the answer and the key to understanding James. Where are we justified by works and not by faith alone? Before God? No. Before the world, right? Before men. James is saying your faith is justified or demonstrated in the world, right? Before men, by your works. And that is of the message that James is giving us. He's not contradicting Paul. Paul lays out very clearly that we are justified by faith alone without the works of the law. But now James is coming around and saying, by the way, the faith that you have before God is justified before men. Is, what does that mean? It's demonstrated before men by your works. Because men cannot see your faith, right? That's why James says here in verse 18, notice, but someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Notice, this is show me and let me show you. Who are they talking about? But with men. God is not saying, show me your works so that I can believe you or that I can accept you. No. God accepts us by faith alone. But before men, in the world, I need more than your faith. As a matter of fact, what I need from you as your neighbor is what? Your works. Your works of kindness. Your works of service. Your works of benevolence for me. And that is how we show each other our faith. So notice then that James is talking about a different realm of justification. Paul talks about being justified before God, right? And James is talking about being justified in the world before men. Okay, you have faith. Okay, show me your faith. How? How are you going to show me your faith? How are you going to be justified before me in your faith? Or how are you going to evidence? How are you going to manifest that faith before me, your brother or your neighbor? By works. Certainly by works. It cannot, your faith must have the works that will impact me, that will touch me. Because if I have a need and you tell me, okay, I have great faith, then what would I say? Yeah, but I need a piece of bread. Yeah, but I need clothing, right? Yeah, but I need, you know, a hug, an embrace, right? So that's what James is saying. You know, show me, justify your faith in the world before men by your works, because that is how faith is justified. Not just by faith. We're justifying not just by faith. Okay, but where? Because Paul has said, yes, by faith alone, we are justified. But where? Before God. Before the court of heaven. But James is talking about being justified where? Here in the world. Before men. Show me your faith and I will show you mine. How? By our works. By our mutual works of service for each other. So that way then faith, it says in verse 22, faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect. What that means is that faith, this word for perfect here, is a word of fulfillment. It's a word of finishing or taking something to completion. To fulfill a task. To finish a task. To meet its goal. What is the goal of the faith that we have before God? What is God pursuing by granting us faith? Number one, yes, that we will be reconciled with him. But through faith in the world, what does God seek with granting us faith? That faith will work in love. That is how faith is made perfect. Where? In the world. That's what faith is granted unto us, that we may love one another. That we may love God, that we may demonstrate that love by loving one another. The demonstration that we love God, guess what? The demonstration in the world that we love God is that we love one another. That's how faith gets justified in the world, and that's how faith reaches its goal in the world. That's what it's designed to do. That's how it meets its objective in the world, by loving. Or the way that Paul would put it in Galatians 5, faith working through love. So that's the point of chapter 2 of James. There's no need to be confused here on this matter, and to let either any one of those that would want to befuddle this chapter here confuse us. Okay, once again, where are the errors? The errors are in saying, on the one hand, oh, you cannot be saved before God by faith alone. You need to add works. We need to recognize an error there and say, no, that's not so. That's not what the Bible teaches, okay? So we reject that. And then, on the other hand, we reject also the following. There's no need for works. Matter of fact, you can have faith and have absolutely no works. It's okay. It don't matter. Faith, works don't matter for anything. They say, no, they do matter a great deal. As a matter of fact, true faith will manifest itself in the world through good works. There will be evidence of that faith. As little as it may be, as immature as a believer may be, as sometimes carnal, in the flesh a believer may be, a believer is never completely bereft, meaning without some measure of love for God that manifests itself in love for neighbor. For the sake of Christ. Those are the kinds of works that the believer has for the sake of Christ. What does it mean for the sake of Christ? Because Christ has loved me and he has saved me and he's had mercy on me. Then there is a measure of compassion and good works of mercy and kindness that flow from a heart that has come to know the gospel. Does that make sense? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it also, that phrase for the sake of Christ, also we honor Christ.
Mm-hmm.
When we do these works,
mm-hmm.
good works unto others, we honor
him. Mm-hmm.
His name is like, oh wow, because he's a Christian.
That's right.
Because of Christ.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
If we dishonor him, we do bad works.
Exactly. Yeah. So any questions on chapter 2? Any questions on this topic? Yeah. Sure. Okay. I know. Yeah, definitely. Absolutely. No. Yes. Absolutely. Yep. Any other questions?
Could you say that these works also serve as testimony? Not only to the fact that we are saved.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, in a big, on Judgment Day, okay, on Judgment Day, at the end of time, our works are going to acquire a very important role. Why? Because when we are resurrected, and we are either resurrected and acquire in resurrection a new body, or we are transformed because we're alive, and we are transformed. Those that did not sleep in Christ, or those that are not in Christ, will also be, appear before God's court and God's tribunal, okay? What these non-regenerate, non-believers will have for their defense is the following. We did good works. We're good people. They have no other defense. The only thing they have that they're going to cling to, which they are doing now, is justify themselves. They are going to be saying, what do you mean you're going to send us to hell? When we are good people, good persons, can be. What do you mean? Look at that Christian over there. That Christian, I mean, I was a faithful husband for 40 years. And that Christian had 3 marriages. You mean to send me to hell? And that person's going to go to heaven? Come on, God, there's something wrong with this picture. They are going to claim their good works, their morality, their status as good people. That's what all false religions have. They're based on their works, their own righteousness, okay? Then God is going to do something very interesting. He's going to show believers' good works, that lousy Christian of 3 divorces and all of that, okay? He's going to put on display before non-believers the good works of the lousy 3 divorced Christian. And he's going to show in whatever little works he had that what he did for the sake of Christ. He's going to show, you see this 3 divorced Christian? You see this guy that was wrestling with this sin throughout his life? You see him? Let me show you this picture here for a moment. See that guy one day stopped and helped his neighbor because he was moved to compassion and freely out of love, because he knew my love, because my love compelled him. What he did to that neighbor in that occasion, what he did to his brother or sister, what he did in church, he did compelled, moved freely, because he knew my love. And he was moved to doing those little good works for my sake. It was truly love of God that compelled them through Christ. Did you?
Can you show me one?
Can you show me at least one that you did for this? Did you stay in marriage for 40 years for the sake of Christ? Because you were compelled by free love, knowing yourself to be forgiven, and that is why you served your spouse in marriage? Is that what you were doing that? No, just being a good person. Let me tell you, your good works are dirty, filthy rags. You were not clothed with the righteousness of my Son. And that is shown in the fact that your good works are not done for the sake of Christ. So our good works will testify on judgment day against unbelievers' claim to good works. So they will serve an evidentiary purpose and manifested, in other words, it'll become clear that the things that we did in the Lord, as opposed to non-believers. And because of that, we will judge the world. For the sake of Christ, we're not even, really, Lord? Yeah, that's true. I remember I did do that because I was moved by your love. Yeah, that's true. I didn't think of it that way at the time, but yeah. Yeah. And then the Lord gets magnified, praised, and glorified in his bride, who is there now wearing white and clothed and displayed in white linen in the righteousness of Christ. And unbelievers are there being prepared, serving, giving account before God on the basis of their works and being sent to hell. No one will be able to stand on their own righteousness. Yeah.
And, thinking that way, I never thought about it that way, but that way is very clear. Not even us judging.
No, no.
Directly.
Of course. See, remember, the Bible says that God will judge the world in righteousness through his Son. But we are the bride. He's going to use the bride
to... No, that evidence that you're talking about.
Yeah.
That evidence that accuses.
Sure, exactly, exactly, exactly.
You don't have to bring anything up. It's just right there.
Yeah, yeah. It's bride and bride acting on behalf or for the sake of Christ. Did you? No.
And the funny thing is that you won't even know it.
Wait, you won't even know.
You won't even know.
That's what's beautiful about it. That's what, makes it, that's what makes it pure. Because you don't know.
That's what free love is. It's free. See, true love is free love. What does it mean to free love? When you don't have to do it. You don't have to do anything for God to love you. That's how free we are. I understand some people want to contaminate that. But you're free. You're free. You've been set free from what? From condemnation. The law said, do this and you shall live, right? The law kept you bound under in your sin. Why? Because you could never provide what the law demanded, which is do all things and you shall live. But folks, we have been set free from that principle. We are no longer bound by a principle of do this and you shall live. Now we live by a different principle, which is this: believe in Christ and you have eternal life. And everything has been done for you. We are at heart unbelievers. That sounds too good to be true, does it not? It does.
That's not our nature.
It's not.
We would do the opposite.
Exactly. We are accustomed from birth to, you know, to work for what we get. We work for what we get. And we import that into our spirituality. We want to work for what we get. In other words, we get law. Law we get. We don't get grace. Grace is foreign. It's alien. It's weird. It's not something we get.
It sounds absurd.
It sounds counter. It doesn't compute in our hearts. It doesn't. That's why it says it pleased God to save the world by the foolishness of the message preached. It is foolish. You mean to tell me that the wicked are going to be let go because they trusted in Christ? And me, who I am a better, more humane, moral, this or that, whatever you want to say, I am going to be held guilty? It doesn't compute, you see?
I would be doing works, and they weren't with bad intent. They were good intent, right? I was trying to please God all the time. Right? And there's nothing wrong with, I think, with trying
sure.
to please God.
Sure, sure, yeah.
But there was something there of, does he love me enough? You know?
Yeah.
Am I doing enough to deserve his love?
Yes.
Is there something that...
Yes.
Is he happy with me right now?
Right, right.
What can
right.
I do to make him happy?
Exactly.
And that, I didn't realize before, yeah. but that carries...
Of course, of course.
It doesn't sound like it.
No, no. It sounds like the right thing to do.
Yeah.
Sounds like the right thing to do.
Yeah. That freedom of just knowing that he's your dad.
Yeah, yeah. By the way, that's what we should, as parents, communicate to our children. But the problem is that we're giving our children law left and right. And we have to give them... You know, we have to give them some rules and we have to give them, that's all fine. But, if our kids, if all they get is, I'm okay because I've been a good boy, because I've done good, because I've obeyed, there's something very wrong with that. By the time they get to college, they become atheists. Because they don't know grace. By the time they get real and honest with themselves, they say, I ain't that good. And my father's not around now, and I want to do this or that. What's going on with me? God can no longer be happy with me. And they abandon the faith. We should be communicating to our kids, we love you no matter what. We love you no matter what. You are my child no matter what. You are, I forgive you no matter what. I know, that's radical grace. That's the grace of the gospel.
I think God gives such an awesome opportunity to do that when our kids fail.
That's right, that's exactly right. That's right. Isn't that what God says to us? Hey, you're my son. You're free. Remember, you're my son. You prodigal son stuff, right? Comes over, make me as one of your workers. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Hey, you're my son. Come on. Let me prove it to you. Let me put this royal robe on you and give you this ring and make it part of you. You're my son. Never stop to being my son. Wow. That's the kind of stuff that's going to stir up your love for God. That's the kind of stuff that will set you ablaze to freely then love Him. But because it is not natural, we need to constantly be hearing it, so that we can be constantly working the good works of free love. Because we forget and we want to go back to working for wages. You know?
So is it safe to say that the world will be morally judged by the law then?
Absolutely.
And that's why the Bible says everyone
will be judged by the law, including ourselves. You know, the thing is that we have a substitute. We have a law keeper. And that is, we have one that did it for us. And that's why we stand justified and accepted before God. And those that do not stand in that righteousness of the Son, what do they have? Their own righteousness. And God is going to show them that's not enough. They didn't make it. And that's why even in all things that we do, we're always confessing. We're always realizing that even the good that we do is still mixed up with a lot of our own things. But we realize it. Because now, the good thing about freedom is you no longer have to hide. Is that you can now be honest with God and say, yeah, you know what? I realize, Lord, the way that I did that, forgive me, Lord. You know, and that is purifying your conscience, your thoughts. It's freeing you. It's freeing you to love better. You know, to go back at it and give of yourself freely, freely. This is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us first. And true love is not perfected in fear, right? Because fear carries torment, punishment with it. So that whoever fears has not been perfected in love. Now, we all fear. None of us has been perfected completely. But as we continue to hear, you're perfect and complete in Christ, then fruits of that love can arise, can continue to flourish, to arise in us. All right, any more questions on chapter 2? Very good. Well, let's go to chapter 3, and I promise you, brace yourself. We're entering into a very challenging chapter. Chapter 3. Let's read verses 1 through 12. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn their whole body. Look also at ships. Although they are so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and creature of the sea, is tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same opening? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives? Or a grape vine bear figs? Thus no spring yields both salt water and fresh. Let's keep reading. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, demonic. For where envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Wow. Yes. Wow indeed, right? Who can read this chapter and not be convicted by it? Right? The chapter is saying we all have a little member in our bodies that we can control. The tongue. Yeah. And just by way of witness right now, folks, how many of us said, gosh, why did I say that? And why did I tell that person such a thing? Why did I gossip like that? My goodness, I was talking about that person and I wanted to sound like I was saying something nice about her, but in reality, I was cutting her down. You know, I brought up that person just to make me look good. You know, I pointed out that other person's faults with, it seems, a godly intention, but I was actually judging her. You know, and on and on and on and on. Our tongue is expressing things that are not the peaceable, the gentle, the benevolent, and the peacemaking ways. Can we acknowledge that? Yeah. So James is hard-hitting, okay? is hard-hitting to show us how our faith is called to be justified in the world, to be manifested in the world, to be shown in the world. And the tongue is a very fitting example of how we fall short, right? Because, sometimes we're very selective when it comes to sin, right? You know, we talk about the homosexuals, right? The adulterers, this and that. But here it's interesting, James picks on this tongue, right? And folks, I think it goes to the fact that it is the tongue that manifests ultimately whether or not we are in Christ. I know that we would like to say, well, it's the things that we do. Yeah, true. Things that we do ultimately show that. But part of the things that we do is the things that we say. And why is that? Well, because the Bible says, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The Bible puts great emphasis on the mouth, the tongue, and our confession, what we speak. Jesus said, when talking to to the Pharisees, who made a big deal that the disciples were not washing their hands, etc. And he said, it's not what goes in your mouth that pollutes a man. It's what comes out of the heart. And then he goes, for out of the heart comes. And then he goes down a list. You know, that's in Matthew chapter 12. Let's just go there, just to take. Yeah, let's just go there real quick. Matthew chapter, 12, let me see, maybe 15. Let me place. 15, right? Okay, good. Let me place myself here. Yeah, Matthew 15. Matthew 15. Yeah. So, Verse 11. Not what goes into the mouth defiles a man, but what comes out of the mouth, this defiles a man. Then his disciples came and said to him, do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this saying? Wow. Yeah, they were offended when you called them on their hypocrisy. Right? Because the Pharisees were saying, we're good. We're good folks. You know, we've got this righteousness deal down pat, right? We're righteous. We're good. And then he says, verse 13, but he answered and said, every plan which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind leads the blind, both will fall into a ditch. Then Peter answered and said to him, explain this parable to us. So Jesus said, are you also still without understanding? Do you not yet understand that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and is eliminated? But those things which proceed out of the mouth, those things which proceed out of the mouth come from? The heart, and they defile a man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornication, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile a man. So, the things that we say manifest, right, what is in our hearts. And we don't necessarily have to say them out loud sometimes, right? We can hear, right, our heart speak, right? We can hear those evil thoughts. We can hear those rumblings. We can hear the murmuring. We can hear the envy. We can hear the accusations. We can hear the complaining, right? We hear it, right? What do we do? Now, at the end of the day, this is going to go to the tongue, right? It's going to go to the tongue. It's going to be manifested in the tongue. And it's going to go somewhere. It's going to go somewhere. Obviously, sin from the heart running its course through the mouth that we can control. Boom, it just goes, right? Running its course from the mouth. And obviously, as it runs its course, not only does it defile us, but it also hurts other people. It also hurts others. It's very destructive, right? It's very destructive. What do we do? Where does our help come from, right? Our help comes from the Lord, right? And how do we do, where is the remedy? Where is the remedy? Another tongue. A pure tongue. Another word. A word that does not come from our hearts. A word that comes from outside of us. The word of the gospel. So this shows us that we're not in control. We depend on Christ. We depend on the word of Christ so that we can be transformed. Notice that it says faith comes by hearing. Hearing the words of my heart. Hearing the word of God. So notice that if faith comes by hearing, that means somebody's got to be speaking. Right? And James is confronting us with our own stuff to take us to God's answer. In this case, is our own words, our own hearts, our own discourse, our own speech, right? And then he takes us to, and notice that it begins, it's interesting, that this chapter opens up with teachers. It says, teachers are going to receive a stricter judgment. Why? Because teachers of the word of God, and that's not just pastors, even though pastors are called to preach and teach the word of God, but at the end of the day, we're all called to speak the word of Christ to one another, to teach somebody, to lead somebody. How are we going to do it? With the word of Christ. Colossians says, let the word of Christ dwell richly in you, exhorting one another, right? Singing psalms one to another. So the words of our tongue, right, are words that are going to arise from our hearts, right? But what is in the heart is going to come from the words of another. Are we following that? So faith comes by hearing by the word of Christ. So how are we finally going to be led, right, onto a different path? Well, we need to hear the teacher, the good teacher. Be careful when you teach, he's saying here, because you're going to receive stricter judgment. In other words, you're going to be to give account for what you spoke. Isn't that what Paul says? You're going to give account for every word, right? Every idle word. So what does that mean? Okay, are we then understanding that our words and our tongue needs redemption, and that it's not by our own counsel that we are redeemed, but that we must listen to the teacher who failed not, the good prophet, the prophet who taught with perfection, the prophet whose counsel is a counsel of God, who did not sit in the seat of the scornful, right? Who always brings the counsel from God. Who are we talking about? Christ Jesus. You see how every text ought to take us back there? Convicting us and taking us where? To Christ Jesus. Let me show you something very interesting here. So we see, my brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. So notice then that it has to do with teaching. Because that tongue wants to rule itself. That tongue, that heart, wants to be its own counselor and its own teacher. So be careful how we're teaching. Right, its own judge. That's what he's going to say. That's what it's going to say later on. Exactly. That's what it's about. Its own judge, its own teacher, its own counsel. Okay? So what do we need? We need the wisdom that is from above. Who brought us that wisdom? Christ did. Christ did. We need, yes, there's hope. Yes, there's hope. As we remain in the counsel of the teacher from heaven. Yeah. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Wow. You're putting together the pieces. James has said that. Be slow to speak and quick to hear. God is speaking. The word of God is there. The counsel of God. So, and then he goes on to say, because the anger of men does not produce the righteousness of God. In other words, when we're judging, when we're boasting, when we are giving our own counsel, then we get pushed by our anger and inflamed. And men, does a tongue follow there, expressing and being the channel of that whipping? Right? What's the answer? Hey, be slow to speak, quick to hear. To hear who? Christ Jesus, our teacher, our Savior. Be quick to hear the gospel. That wisdom you're going to see in the teacher, in the counselor, in the prophet. Wisdom that is peaceable. Wisdom that is gentle, right? Wisdom that does not lead to quarrels, but that is able to speak to your heart and to your tongue peace. Be still. That's good, right? For God to say that to our tongues, be still.
Yeah,
be still.
Really, yeah. It rings in my ear every time. All my life it happens to me.
Yeah. That's right. That's right.
And I think of the words right away.
Yes.
I'm sure I have some other people. But I do something or I say something.
And boy.
5 minutes later, because of his love, you are in that same spot.
That's right. That's exact. That, folks, that is the testimony of the teacher from above. That is the testimony of the teacher from above. That's why I say, who is the hypocrite? He who never owns up to his own hypocrisy. I'm not a hypocrite. Oh, wow, wonderful. So you have it all together. You're the judge, right? You're not. No, we deal in hypocrisy. And we give it. We dish it out with the tongue. We present one face and we mean something else. We play along for our own benefit. We use partiality. We don't really open up our and say, hey, this is the way I feel and this is what it's happening and this is so and so, and I want to do you good.
You know what? In our we let others do it for us.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Stay back, let them do it.
What get in trouble?
I wasn't part of that.
Yeah. Right. So we are in this boat, folks. The Holy Spirit will bring us conviction and will say that you are the man. And that's what the Bible is always doing. You are the man. You're the one who needs a Savior. And then by the Holy Spirit of God, we say, yes, Lord, I need this wisdom from above. And then we do something with our tongues. What do? We confess. We confess. We pray. Notice the tongue again. We pray. We hear our confession in prayer. That is the Holy Spirit giving us, right? That word. The Apostle Paul said, I believe, therefore I spoke. You see? So whoever believes in his heart that Jesus is Lord and confesses with his mouth that God raised him from the dead. What does that mean? What it means is that what you believe in the heart finds a way to be the teacher in your life, the audible word that leads you. That's why the word is so important in the Bible. God leads us by his word. And sometimes, that's why we need to speak it to one another, but when there's no one around, we need to speak it to ourselves. David used to do that. Wait on the Lord, O my soul, for I shall yet praise Him. Why are you downcast within me, my soul? You see, David's talking to himself. He's crazy. He's going, no. No, he is bringing the confession of the word. Obviously, it not as the false teachers. Oh, you confess and you make it happen. That's not what's happening here. It's that we are speaking in conformity with the word of God, with the word of the gospel, with the promise of the gospel in Christ. And that way we keep ourselves in the love of God. I think it's keep yourselves in the love of God. Let me see something here. Judas. verse 21. I was mixed up with Spanish. Jude, which is only one chapter, has in verse 21. Let's read verse 20 and 21 because it wraps up this theme of speaking of the tongue. How is the tongue going to be controlled? It's going to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. And how will the Holy Spirit control it? The Holy Spirit will control it by bringing unto you the word of Christ in prayer and in confession. Notice what it says here in verse 20 and 21. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. Praying in the Holy Spirit is not praying unintelligible things. It's praying according to the promises and the wisdom of God in Christ. It's praying in the count. It's on the word of God. Now you come and you pray, right? The will of God. That's what we have in the Lord's Prayer, by the way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That's praying in the Holy Spirit. Thy kingdom come, your kingdom rule over me. Your will be done. Have your will done in me, Lord. And see, give us this day our daily bread. Oh, Lord, feed me, nourish my soul, provide for me. So you're praying, right, in Christ, the will of God for your life, not your own desires, not your own imaginations, not your own pronouncements and decrees. I declare this, I declare that. That's a bunch of garbage. That is not praying in the Holy Spirit. Neither is praying with gibberish, praying in the Holy Spirit. So praying in the Holy Spirit, verse 21, keep yourselves in the love of God. You see? Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. So we are going to be then bringing to recall the message of the gospel unto our own lives and keeping ourselves in that word, hoping and waiting on the mercies of Christ through confession, through repentance, and through faith, and through asking of the Lord according to His will. Any questions? We'll come back to this. There's a lot here to keep. I want to share some other things from this chapter. And I want to show you something that Jesus did when He addressed the Pharisees that have to do with the teaching, with the tongue, with being evil judges. Any questions? So don't be discouraged by the evil that our hearts spew out. Huh? But as you notice it, ask the Lord obviously to give you conviction. Confess. This is wrong. Grieve. James is going to come around and say, let your laughter turn to mourning. You shouldn't be happy when this is what you are, you know, trafficking in all day long. That's not how your faith is justified in the world. That's not how your faith is called to act in the world. Look at your tongue. look at and notice. Notice the state of your faith. It's right there evidenced in what is coming out of your mouth, right?
It's also important that you also underline that a few times, the connection between the evidence that comes out and the heart.
Yes,
because
yes.
Some would say, well, look, you know, I'm going to be more prudent.
Shut my mouth. Right.
But then, you know,
yeah.
Your heart.
Right, right.
You don't understand. It's there.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yes. Yeah. And body language sometimes betrays you. Oh, I'm peaceful. Yeah. Yeah, breathing. Right. Yeah. Yeah. So that's why then we hear the discourse of our heart. And folks, this is really what how the Lord leads us to deep confession, because we really come face to face with the sinfulness of our hearts. We don't have to do anything else. All we got to do is listen to our hearts to have a lot to confess. To be humbled by our need of the Savior. And praise God, He's there for you. He's there for you. As you just come pleading your mercy, I need you, Lord. Yes, that's me. Rescue me. I need this wisdom from above. And then he begins to, right, to tame your tongue, because He's taming your heart. Because He's causing you to say, man, that person, I'm no better than that person, really. I mean, why am I being so tough on her or him when You've been so merciful with me, Lord, please. Next time that I think about it, this comes up again, Lord, please help me. Help me to wish her good. Help me to pray for her, Lord, and really desire their restoration, their good, their, you know, so we begin to see what's wrong in confession and prayer and ask the Lord to give us what we lack, right?
You know, I think in essence, maybe, I'm thinking the tongue is kind of like a gauge of everything else. Mm-hmm. And you hear it come out, there it is.
Yeah. Praise God. Let's finish in prayer. Father, thank You. Thank You for tonight, Lord. Father, for giving us this word that we need to hear. Thank You for this letter of James. I've gained such an appreciation for it as I have been teaching it, Lord. And You reveal things to us that are here in the sacred text of Your word, Father. Lord, make it alive by Your Spirit, Lord, in our hearts, that we may receive it with meekness, that we may confess and look above where our help comes from. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.